Well, I guess we could have just kept going, but first of all, retirement.
Yeah.
You were behind that mic for a long time, and it doesn't seem like you're having a terrible time as a retiree. Talk about what the last year and a half has been like. You enjoying retirement? Are you enjoying life?
You know, Mike, I tell people, constantly people ask me, I'll be in Kroger because we're in there 3 or 4 days a week. We go day to day, Amanda and I do. We don't make a grocery list out, so we go. And inevitably somebody will say, how do you like retirement? And my pat answer is, had I known it was going to be as good as it's been, I'd have done it before I did it. And I truly, genuinely mean that. When Joe retired, I felt like he waited a little bit too long because there were a lot of things that he wanted to do that because of physical problems he was unable to do. And I made a pact with myself then. That's not going to happen to me. And I'm healthy. And Amanda doesn't allow me to let any grass grow under my feet. And we travel extensively. And I would wish the enjoyment that I've had in retirement to everybody. Because I know a lot of people have done it, and they said if I had to do it all over again, I wouldn't do it. And I, not one time has it ever crossed my mind. I've just had a wonderful time, and going to Ireland for 2 weeks and playing golf this past summer, and going on a river cruise out of Prague next June, and we just do a lot of cool things, and it's been thoroughly enjoyable for me.
And that's the sign of a man who's happy in his personal life. And when I ask this, you don't need to go back.
No, I
talk about the mistakes of past relationships, but meeting Amanda, enjoying your life now, what's this second chance in life and love meant to you?
Well, it's meant everything to me. In fact, I've had people say to me, and I don't think you notice it because you're living it, but I've had friends of mine that have said to me, you became an entirely different person. And I said, I don't feel like I have. They said, well, believe me, from those of us who looked at you up close or looked at you from afar, your personality has changed. Now, that's not to say that we don't go to war, because we can do battle like nobody's business, even though, I mean, I'm 80 and she's 50, and we can go to war, but we get it all out. And she's been a blessing to me. I don't know where I'd be without her. When she leaves home and goes away, and periodically she'll take a trip with her sister, which she's on right now, and I just don't feel completely whole when I go to bed at night, when I wake up in the morning. And I'm around that big house, rumbling around with Millie, our cat, and dog, and Baby, our cat, and it's just us three. And I'm the only one talking. And so it's been a good thing for me.
Hopping all around here, of course. If I have you for a conversation, we need to talk about the team you've covered mm-hmm. for so many years. You see all these contracts in baseball, 13 years, $300 gazillion, dollars, all these different contracts. It is hard to compete if you're the Cincinnati Reds and you don't spend that kind of money. Are you ambivalent? Are you frustrated? Are you sad when you see the state of baseball and where the Reds fit into it? It makes them difficult to be a winner. We talk about the rebuild and all that, and
yeah.
That's great. But at the end of the day, you need a couple of proven stars.
It's a real tough situation. And what I find amusing is people are critical of this ownership because they don't spend any money. It's not your damn money. And I always have to catch myself and say, you know, it's easy for me to be critical because it's not my money. It's not my money, it's somebody else's money. And so I have a hard time doing that. Having said that, I can understand the frustration on the part of fans when they see the San Francisco Giants sign Carlos Correa to a 13-year contract, and all the rest of the guys that have signed contracts in excess of 10 years in the last number of months. You know, Steve Cohen bought the New York Mets, and he had one goal in mind. We're talking about the wealthiest owner, I think, in Major League Baseball. And his goal was, I will spend whatever I have to spend, and I will not add the clause within reason. There is no reason to the amount of money I will spend in order to put this team in a position to be in the postseason and win a world championship. Everybody, God bless his ale out of him in New York because of what he's doing. And then you compare that to a small market club like the Reds have, and there is no way in the world they're going to spend that kind of money. The only hope they can hang on to is to develop young players in their system in abundance, some of whom will come up here and hopefully make this club a contending club, some of whom will be guys that would be packaged to be traded off to another club to get a veteran or a couple of veterans that they need to plug holes in elsewhere. And that takes time. I mean, I'm sure people realize if you're banking on this club to be an impact player in 2023, that's not going to happen. 2024, I think, is what they're shooting for. I think this coming year they're going to have very good pitching because of these three kids that they had last year, and Green and Lodolo and Ashcraft, and they've got another kid in Connor Overton who was with them briefly early in the year, pitched extremely well, got hurt, was done for the year. And a kid that they traded from Seattle in the Suarez-Winker deal. Their bullpen's going to be better because they're going to have guys coming back that weren't there last year, and Lucas Sims and T.J. Antone. They're going to have a hard time scoring runs. And we all know in baseball knowledge 101, if you ain't scoring, you ain't winning. Mm-hmm. They're going to have to do something offensively. How they're going to do that, I don't know. That's not my job. That's Nick Kroll's job. But they've got to come up with additional offense to give themselves a reasonable chance of winning.
In the NBA, Jerry West is the emblem for the league.
Yes.
You've covered the Reds for – you were in that booth for four decades plus. Is there one Red that would be your emblem, that would be the guy? When you think of the franchise, I know there's a lot of things, unfortunately.
That's tough.
They go into this because of some off-field stuff, but just on the playing field, who would be your guy?
I don't know. That's a hell of a question. My answer would be with prejudice because I was so close to Joe Morgan. He's the smartest guy I've ever been around in baseball. You know, we tragically lost him a couple of years ago. He and I were dear, dear friends. Pete and I are dear, dear friends. I don't know who you would pick. I'd be inclined to think, to some extent, I think about Frank Robinson, who was a part of the worst trade that's probably ever made by this franchise, and maybe the worst in baseball, when they traded him to Baltimore thinking he was done. He went over and won an MVP award. That's a great, nobody's ever asked me that question, and I don't know how I would respond to that because there have been so many fine players. You'd have to throw Johnny Bench into the mix. I mean, he's the greatest player in the history of baseball at a given position. I say that to groups and people come up and say, he's not the greatest player in the history of baseball. I said, that's not what I said. At a given position, he revolutionized how the catching position was played. So I can't answer that question. And I'll give you an A because that's the first time anybody's ever asked me that question.
I think you did, though, which is good. You talked about some of those guys. Because of your job, you've gotten to meet a lot of amazing people, mm-hmm. I'm sure, over the years. Is there one meeting, one conversation, one dinner that you can talk about, that's something you'll always remember that you got to do because you were a baseball announcer?
I don't think I interviewed anybody that countless other people have never interviewed. I was awfully impressed by young George Bush when he came to Cincinnati as President of the United States and was as down to earth as you are. I mean, I was amazed. And then I got a call. I haven't told this story very often. I got a call a week before Halloween, and he was going to be at Great American Ballpark for a rally. It was 2 days before the election, and I got a call from the White House, would you MC the event? And I said, yeah, I will. And I was there, Bench was there, Anthony Munoz was there, the place was packed. And I got a chance to talk to him afterwards. And he said, I think you should know that I'm a big fan of a fella who's been successful having a son follow in his same footsteps. And I got a nice letter from him when I retired. This is not a political statement, but I was just impressed. I'm often, when I talk to someone who met someone extremely famous that I've never met, and the first question I ask them is, what kind of person is he? Because I don't give a damn about his celebrity. If he's the kind of person that carries himself as a person that anybody can talk to, as well as being a famous, that's, to me, that's more important than his celebrity. And I was just impressed with him. We've had all kinds of people. Jonathan Winters, we had in there one night back at the old ballpark on a rain delay, and he came in. He's a huge Reds fan from Springfield, Ohio, and he came in and did a spontaneous interview that we interviewed him like we would interview some other baseball celebrity. And he was Whip Willis, who owned a used chicken farm, and it went bankrupt. And it was the funniest thing. I mean, we were crying, and that was all off the top of his head. He was brilliant, brilliant. We've had a lot of, you know, musical groups in the booth. I'm a big Chicago fan. We have them in there in the late 70s and early 80s, and I didn't know who they were, and I didn't give them a time of day. And then afterwards, I became a big fan of the group. But we've had some interesting people and great conversations with people. But I would say his interview stood out more so because he's just a nice guy.
You mentioned your son.
Yeah.
We all know what happened.
Yeah.
A lot of people get second chances.
Mm-hmm.
He has not gotten one.
Oh.
What are your thoughts on all of this?
Well, I'm extremely disappointed. And I don't want people to think that I'm condoning what he said. I'm not doing that. And if he were sitting in this chair, he would say the same thing, and has from day one. There have been other people who have said similar things that hardly got a slap on the wrist. And for all intents and purposes, up to this point, his career has ended. I don't think it was handled well locally. I don't think it was handled well at the network level. The members of the gay community in this town, when it happened, would not have given him air in a jug if he were suffocating. And after they got to know him, and after he worked with them, he had a number of them that said, we'll do anything we can to help you get back in the business and get back on your feet again. What he said did not in any way point up what kind of person he is. He's a much better person than I am. He's a man of great faith. He's handled it incredibly much better than I would have ever handled. I would have never been able to handle it the way he's handled it. And he's done a great job. I think about it every day. It bothers me every day that nobody has come forward and saying, hey, it's time to turn the page. You're too good a talent to sit home and not do what you want to do, and that's do play-by-play baseball and play-by-play football. Maybe it'll happen one day, I don't know, but I think about it all the time.
Final thing, and again, hopping all over the place, but here we are in late December, moving into January, and we've got a football team in town that has taken this town by storm. This young quarterback's amazing. We knew at the minute he was drafted that he's one of those Peyton Manning types that for 15 years, you got a shot to win if you build around him.
Right.
How exciting is it to watch that as a guy who grew up, you know, who did his thing in Cincinnati for so many years? And are you more excited than jealous as a Reds fan to watch this all play out?
I watch him every weekend. Amanda and I went down to see them play Kansas City. That was the first time I'd seen the Bengals play locally since November 17th, 1975. I refused to go back down there. Not that anybody cared, but I was just, I felt like that franchise should be run a lot different than it was. I'm thrilled with what they're doing. And to have a kid as talented as he is, and apparently, and I've not met him, a young man who's got his head screwed on right. I got a chance to meet his dad opening day, this past opening day. I was introduced to him. We stood there and talked for 45 minutes. And I walked away from that meeting with his dad thinking, this is why Joe Burrow is the way he is. I think he's had wonderful upbringing, and I think his dad set an example for him. And he's got God-given ability. I'm amazed at how tough he is. He looks like a choir boy. And he takes a beating, and he just keeps coming back. They're playing right now. For me, they're playing as good as I've ever seen a Bengals football team play, better than the one that went to the Super Bowl last year. I'd love to see him go back. because I think the Brown family has put the pieces together that are working, and to go down there and see a game in that football stadium, I was shocked because the noise never stops. Yeah. I mean, from the time they come on the field to the time the horn sounds ending the game, the roar is incessant, and I think it's wonderful. The atmosphere is great, and they are due all the accolades that have come their way, and hopefully they can stay healthy the rest of the way, and they can beat the Ravens, they can beat the Buffalo Bills, they can beat the people they have to. Not be a wild card team, but it'd be great to see them win the division.
Absolutely. I think that's all I need. If you could just stay there for a minute, I'm going to have Brandon.